Okay, so six reasons for forming strategic global business alliances. And so this was done by Daniela Delamonte. I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce her last name. So if you're watching online, I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name. So that's the source for the original article. Okay, so global business alliances, companies decide to form strategic global business alliances for many reasons. One of the most important reasons is to gain access to another country's knowledge or resources. And companies can also decide to join forces to develop new products or to enter a market that neither could enter alone. Other reasons for developing strategic alliances include the following: forming economies of scale, enhancing competitiveness, dividing risks, setting new standards for technology, entering new markets, overcoming the competition in a market, acquiring new skills and resources. And so often when companies cooperate on a project, they exchange skills that are not for sale. Typically, one partner possesses technological expertise and ability to keep abreast of rapidly evolving technological developments. What that partner needs from the other partner or partners is capital, large distribution systems, marketing expertise, service networks, and credibility in the marketplace. Each partner therefore provides the other with vital resources and uses the partnership to extend its skill set into new areas. So here's the first of six reasons for getting into the partnership. One, forming economies of scale. I think that should have been scale, right? Partnerships can generate economies of scale that will enable the participating companies to marshal a broad set of resources and to achieve the critical mass needed for international success. Companies will, with complementary skills, can rely on each other's proven expertise instead of spending time and resources to independently develop what has already been achieved. And Ron was, or Michael, we're talking about the that Ukrainian cargo plane that has the Pratt & Whitney engines made in Montreal, basically, right? So here you have a Canadian engine being put in an Ukraine-built airplane. That's a good example of partnership, I would say. So your Ukrainian airframe builder, which has expertise in building aircraft, you know, requires engines of high quality produced in Canada, and so they come together and produce a better aircraft than they either could do by themselves. In fact, Pratt & Whitney can't build an airplane, and that company, is it Antonov which builds the transport plane?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe, does Antonov have a jet engine division, or do they buy from someone else?
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Do you want me to put you in the picture?
Oh, it's okay, that's fine. So number two, enhancing competitiveness. Many international trade projects require expertise from different fields. Traditionally, companies have tried to develop or maintain all the required skills in-house. However, as technological and administrative complexity increases, companies are learning that they cannot do everything by themselves. As a result, the most competitive corporations are adopting a strategy of maintaining their core competencies only, and gaps in their skill bases are then filled by partnering with the company that has the missing skills. So this strategy avoids the need to expand resources and run the risk associated with developing the skills in-house. And for example, again with that transport aircraft, instead of having to, you know, create a whole engine division, you know, to power your plane, well, why not just partner with somebody who builds engines? So, and in fact, going back to our example I mentioned this morning on the Avro Arrow, that company who had built that advanced fighter not only had developed the plane, but they also had developed the engine. So they were manufacturing a brand new engine, brand new plane as well. And that's one of the reasons they got into big cost overruns. That Avro project, just as an aside, they were never intending to use in their own engine, because the British manufacturer, you know, they ran out of, they stopped production of the RL-101, I think, that was originally supposed to power the Arrow. But that shows what happens if you end up expending too much on too many products. You can actually run your expenses out of your comfort zone, essentially. So dividing the global business risk is number three. Risk sharing through partnership is most often seen in research and development areas. Research and development costs are always increasing, and the speed of innovation means that products rapidly become outdated, and the risk of investing in developing new products are high. Sharing research and development costs and facilities provides good money for value, while sharing expertise can speed up the process. Partnering can be used to share risk in other areas as well. For example, companies can share transportation and distribution systems, which saves money and enables faster delivery of the product. Joint marketing is another way of spreading risk and increasing returns. Number four, setting new standards. The development of new technologies creates entirely new market opportunities. The first company to create a new technology might set the standards for its industry simply because it was the first. However, several competitors might develop similar technologies about the same time. It is very difficult to predict whose technology will set the standard for the industry, so trying to be the first in the market with a new technology can be very risky. Forming alliances is one approach to establish standards in an industry. And of course, I think we're all old enough to remember the computer boom in the 80s when there were so many different computer manufacturers, each trying to vie for dominance. It was interesting, like the first Apple computer, it was a box. It had like a single disk drive, didn't have a hard drive. I think even the first ones didn't even have any graphics. Very limited in scope, but it could do things like word processing, and very important. IBM looked at that particular product and says, you have a floppy disk, but you're only writing on one side. Why don't you write on both sides of the disk? So they immediately doubled the disk capacity. They put in a slightly better processor. They put in a graphics card, so now you can do graphics. So IBM basically took the original Apple box, improved it, and then it became the dominant PC in the offices. And it was only how many years later did it take Apple to make the Macintosh, to do sort of try to come back. Well, by then they lost so much market share, and so many other different companies other than IBM had gone into the PC market as well.
So VHS and Beta.
Yeah. But and that's a case where Beta was actually a superior product, I believe, too, but it just didn't catch on, right? So, in fact, it was only the commercial people were using Beta, and the average person was using.
Well, I remember when I was in high school, the video stores had both VHS and Beta.
Yeah.
That was for a few years, and then I just all went VHS.
Yeah. Five, entering new foreign markets. Strategic business alliances are effective ways of entering a new foreign market. Partners can provide established marketing and distribution systems, as well as knowledge of the markets they serve, ensuring that products get to market faster and are more likely to be purchased. Well, say, for example, if you're a Canadian store, like just take like Farm Boy, for example. Say you wanted to open in Ukraine. Maybe you would, instead of going on your own, you want to partner with somebody, So Hlopets store in Ukraine instead would be your partner,
But that's what TNT did with
Hlopets.
Yeah. Yes.
That's right.
Yeah. For example, I remember Canadian Tire tried to expand the United States. They didn't do it. So maybe they should have partnered with somebody, but they had to withdraw. And we have examples too, even where very big, successful companies in their own right, when they expand to a different market, like Target, when they came to Canada, what happened? Now, I'm not saying Target should have partnered, but maybe they should have maybe partnered a bit. Because back in the old days, you guys remember the Simpsons store in Canada?
Yeah.
When Sears came into Canada, they actually partnered with Simpsons. Then it became Simpsons Sears.
Yeah, right.
So they became part of the whole, they integrated into the Canadian retail marketplace without being totally foreign. They were using established Canadian company to make it easier for them.
Walmart didn't care. Mm-hmm. Walmart was different.
Yeah. As just an aside, speaking of Sears, its first store actually was at Carlingwood. That was their entry store when that was Simpson Sears at Carlingwood, and that was the model store to become all the Simpson Sears stores all across Canada. Then of course Simpsons disappeared and it just became Sears. Okay. Foreign partners can advise a company how quickly modify a product to meet local regulations and market conditions. And again, if you're going into Ukraine, you may want to change slightly the flavor of a drink, right? To match local sort of conditions, So.
Maybe pulling up on that market purposes is how you market the product, like for advertising.
Yeah.
I remember watching once when the Kentucky Fried Chicken went into Japan. And what they did is, rather than what they do in the States or Canada, they started how Colonel Sanders was a young boy and he had all these spices and stuff. And that caught on, and the Kentucky Chicken really took off in Japan, because the way they did the marketing to meet the advertising to meet the Japanese standards.
And one of the things you can do when you go to a country that has a different language than your own is your partner can help with issues such as translation of documentation, conversion from metric to imperial, that's more of an American thing, conversion of power requirements, which is real, and compliance with packaging regulations. So, and of course, in a country like Ukraine, it's a multilingual country, right? Depending on what part of the nation you're in, you may want to be English, Ukrainian, Russian, or English, Russian, depending on where you want, depending on your local market conditions. Okay, overcoming competition. So companies often cooperate in marketing or distribution to overcome competition. So for example, like, you know, if you want to go into Ukraine and you have a company that does the same thing that you do, well, again, why don't you just join them? Like, again, the Simpsons-Sears analogy. You know, Sears did not compete with Simpsons. They joined Simpsons. So. Maybe Walmart, maybe Target should have done that, eh? Maybe Target should have merged with Canadian Tire, I don't know. Could have been Target Tire.
They had a different issue, though. They were offloading distressed merchandise in Canada. So that's not the Target that they have in the
States. No,
really.
Yeah.
The stores I went to, the Target stores I went to, often I went there, and the inventory was very low. Like, it'd be like the electronics section, there's hardly anything in there.
Yeah. If you went to the Target stores out of the border, you wouldn't see all that product.
No.
Samples. So I think they were just using that as the offset of the losses.
Give it to Mikey will try anything. Mm-hmm.
But that's a good example of how not to do things. You know, don't. You know, dump your product in another country. Hopefully, it's going to be successful. Okay, so forming alliance with established major company can reduce the influence of other companies. However, companies should be careful that alliances do not form a cartel or otherwise breach anti-competition laws in the target market. And that's something you've got to be aware of. You know, so if you're going into Ukraine or some other country, and you're going to target, you're going to merge with somebody, you're the only company in that country. Or that you're such a dominant player, you may, you know, find that you're going to get trouble from the government from, again, these anti-competition laws. So it's one of the curses of success. You become too big and too powerful, then you become a target, but target in a different way.
I don't pun intended there.
Okay. So, like I mentioned, this content is an excerpt from the FITT Skills International Market Entry Strategies textbook. It basically is to enhance your knowledge and credibility with the leading international trade training and certification experts. So FIT stands for Forum for International Trade Training. So I'm a graduate of this program, and I have a diploma in international trade, and I'm a certified international trade practitioner. As an aside, too, when you take the first four courses, you'll get a certificate, so they'll actually mail you or give you your certificate in international trade. You can hang it on the wall, show that to people.
Mike, is it classwork or is it done?
Classwork. Or online, you know.
How long did it take you to go through to become certified?
Because it's a part-time program.
Yeah.
You take the courses when they become available. Also, I noticed Algonquin College, they have a one-year international trade program too, where they have more than the courses. I think they have 10. So they have the core FIT courses, and they've added a few more of their own as well to round it off and make it a bit more.
So you get the same designation.
Yeah, at the end of it, once you've finished all the courses, then you apply to the Forum for International Trade Training for certification. You know.
And how long is your certification good for?
It's 1 year. You have to renew it every year.
Just by paying?
Yeah.
How much does that cost?
It's around $240, $250, something like that. It's pretty hefty in cost. I mean, I'm a teacher, and I don't have my teacher certification is only like $110, $115 a year, something like that. and you need that to work. You don't necessarily need a CITP certification, but it's a useful thing to have. You know.
What have you done with it, Michael?
Not that all that much, really. It's more for future sort of use. And it was based on my enthusiasm for doing work in Ukraine, you know. So, like, it's still, like, my knowledge of, that I attained is still there. Because, you know, the first module, what they do is it's an overview view of the entire program. There's 8 modules, and it'll talk about things like entrepreneurship, marketing, doing a marketing plan, doing a business plan. It'll cover international trade, finance, accounting, and the whole thing like that. And then the next course you take will be something like marketing. And in that course, you'll do a marketing plan. And then, the next course you take, it'll be finance or something like that. And so,
but you are not. You don't need this certification to do the stuff you would do with it.
No, the whole goal of that program was to train people to give them the basic minimal skills for them to do international trade. You know, I've seen a few companies having job advertisements where they say having a CITP is helpful. But this isn't very common, I've noticed, in the marketplace, you know, requiring a CITP. So. Other things they teach are things like logistics, you know, like the whole chain from packaging to transportation, you know, to doing all the customs documentations when you're doing importing or exporting, which is, you know, part of the whole process.
And maybe this was asked, but when you said Algonquin has 10 courses,
yeah,
are they like full courses or are they just like...
I think that was a full-time program, yeah.
And yours took how long to finish?
It took me about 4 or 5 years.
Oh, so it was quite a bit of work.
No, just because not all courses were available all the time, and I didn't want to take any online courses. I don't like online courses. I like the aspect of being in an international trade course and just talking to people, because you find all these people are involved in all their international, you know, marketing plans. Like, there was one guy here in Ottawa. They were actually making armor for exports for the military, actually, but they didn't know how to do international trade, so they said, okay, well, they sent some of their employees in to get certification, you know, just to get the idea of what's involved, you know.
So, where does training take place here in Ottawa?
It can be at Algonquin College, or it could be at the Forum for International Trade Training, or sometimes they'll go off-site. I remember we were at an office tower on Elgin Street, and we had a classroom there. Mm-hmm. Depends on the rental, what's available. So. Oh,
yes. You should set up a Ottawa Center for International Trade and some memberships.
Right. So, if you're interested, here actually are some handouts from FIT. If you want to just curious what the program is about.
Just one thing, Michael, we should be aware of when we talk about partnerships. Ukraine has a very specific element.
Yeah.
Canadian Tire, the Ottawa franchisee, is one of them. Did try to expand to Ukraine in the late 90s. Mm-hmm. That's what I was doing research for my day. And he got himself a partner who was a government minister at the time, Kipro Petros, a Ukrainian man. They actually set up their version of Canadian Tire. Mm-hmm. Systems, programming, everything went over. They supplied everything from Canada to make the operation run.
Mm-hmm.
Then once it was up and running and the Canadian went there for what would be his final visit, he was told very simply, thank you very much. This is just great. Go home, never come back again, because if you do, they'll find your body in the river.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty
and
serious.
That was it. Yeah. And there was a lot of money that went from Canada, facilities and the information went over there. The guy's name, by the way, the Ukrainian partner, was Lazarenko, who became prime minister and eventually ended up in an American jail.
So we know what.
So, So picking partners in Ukraine. Now, this is going back quite a bit, not to today's period, but there was a specific number of steps you should take, finding reliable people.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the critical things was making sure you didn't have a Ukrainian manager running the operation in Ukraine, because another thing they do quite often, used to do, again, it's changing now, so all these things are... But your manager would steal your company simply by taking the official seals, which are critical there, and selling it out from under you, re-registering it, and then saying, so sad, too bad, you're no longer owner of this company. It's...
So what about the new rules they're putting into place? So supposedly that's trying to clean all this up, though. So.
Yeah, I think there are a number of elements. The new rules, certainly, both from in terms of cleaning up the legal system, getting in judges. Mm-hmm. They're also straightening the business registration laws and the ability of people to do exactly what I've been talking about. it's identifying the person that you're going to be dealing with or the group you're going to be dealing with. And in the old days, it used to sort of work two different ways. Either you come in at the very top, very big, where you're literally talking to the president, who will give you cover, so nobody else is going to touch you. You give you the cliché, as they used to call it. Or else you come in at the very bottom, you find a relative there, and the type of businesses we're talking, you start a small business, registered through your relative who you can trust, hopefully, and you expand that way and develop that way. Now it's becoming different. There are a lot of large international operations, more on the services side, software especially, but even businesses like IKEA and others are coming in.
Yeah.
So IKEA would not come into Ukraine because it would not trust the local legal system.
It's IKEA.
IKEA. Sorry.
The Swedish furniture store.
Yes. Yeah. I pronounce it differently. So what you're talking about, there's a greater and greater chance that you'll come back with your scalp on your head and money in your pocket if you work it well in Ukraine, but it's still difficult finding reliable partners when you're working there.
That's always the case anywhere, though, you go in the world too. So.
Yeah.
But again, like we mentioned, that's like, you know, I don't know, I mean, how good our Canada Korean Chamber of Commerce is, but the Chamber of Commerce is a good conduit to go through, you know. You know, so, yeah.
So. Well, they have these bodies that take care of everything under the table, you know. At the, because we had Walter Kish here, and he was talking about how they formed Seagram's and Kiev, and they just couldn't deal with the system at all, so they paid heavily. A third party to make sure everybody was taken care of.
Actually, that's interesting because
which is illegal under Canadian.
Of course, it's illegal. It was in the early 90s as well.
Well, in the FIT program, actually, they mentioned things like consulting fees or bribes, however you want to look at it. And in some countries in the world, actually, it's part of normal business practice. Like in Japan, you can put down a bribe as part of a, as a business deduction. Whereas the United States, it's very, very strict. If you're an American corporation doing business overseas and you're caught doing bribery, you can be convicted in the United States of that. You know, so it's not really a balanced playing field internationally. You know, so.
I read somewhere once that if you once you bribe somebody or are bribed, you're kind of stuck because then you're beholden. So if you don't want to be in that situation, don't do it.
Well, they also then they expect it too, right?
You don't run for president of the United States.
Yeah.
But when it comes to things like shipping, especially when you're dealing with smaller amounts, I mean, $500 is a smaller amount.
Yeah.
There are firms that can handle it for you. Guys like Mist. Are very good at getting stuff out of Ukraine to Canada and the other way around. You know, so container loads or less. And they're actually quite reliable. They've established a reputation. They look and feel slightly shady, but they get the stuff done.
Yeah. They also do money transfers as well, too.
Yeah.
And they'll actually deliver packages of actual physical cash to people in Ukraine as well. So.
Well, when you did the small book transaction, it was everything was sort of a real anomaly because somebody was paid off in Ukraine to get the books onto the dock. And then when I got to Canada, we paid $100 for customs on a $5,000 order. And that doesn't make any sense to me because I can import something from the United States and have a $100 custom. A duty on that, so like, it was all weird.
What happens is a lot of the companies, good example, UPS, for example, what they will do is if some companies coming from Canada, from the States to Canada, they will put in the highest possible rate of duty or taxes to cover themselves. Because I went to them and I was upset because I knew where the goods should be classified, what the rate of duty should be, but that's when they do business. That means no one will bother to check because you're paying top.
By the way, it's 11 minutes to 12.
Yeah, we've got plenty of time.
Okay. Well, if not any more questions, we can wrap up and we'll come back after around 1 o'clock.
Sure.
You guys, do you want to go gamble or eat or whatever? Or?